rest on us. Come rest on us. Come down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Come, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving.
Present in our midst. Holy Spirit, we invite you to have your way in us. God, do whatever you want to do. You are worthy of our praise. You are worthy of our adoration, God. And we give you permission to do whatever you want to do. Transform us, God, from the inside out. We lift you up in this place, God.
Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Come, let us bow down before Him. His banner is love over us, and His mercies are new every morning. And I sing, oh, 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 oh. And I sing, oh.
So I won't let the rocks cry out in my place. Oh, we return the breath you gave with our praise. Let's cry out to Him. So
yeah.
our cornerstone, high within our hearts, high within our minds.
Yes, Lord, we acknowledge you in your right place. You are higher than all things, yet you are with us in our everyday. And as we walk through and we listen to the words that are said today, as we listen to the stories that are told, we are reminded that you are constantly fighting on behalf of us for your glory. Not just for us, but so that we can be an example of your glory to others. Lord, would you work through us? Would you work in us? Would you transform our hearts? Would you refine the places that need refining? Would you turn our minds from the things that we were focused on that we do not need to be focused on? Lord, let us put you in your right place as we just sang. We love you, Lord, and we worship you, and we continue to worship you right now. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys can have
amen,
a seat.
Amen. So good to worship God, huh? Love being together. Well, welcome to North Coast Calvary Chapel. I'm Kelly Steele Carlson, and I work with our Mission and Community Impact team. And welcome to everyone who is brave in the tent, in the chapel, online. You guys here, we're so glad we get to worship together. And if you're new or visiting, we would love to connect with you. We also have a Belong class, which starts next Sunday, and it's a 3-week membership type class where you get to learn more about our church, our values, who we are, and how you could get plugged in. So we would love to have you join us. You can sign up in the foyer at the information table. So we'd love to have you there. And we also have Super Bowl party, February 12th. We're gonna host it here on this big screen, take advantage of it. So burgers and hot dogs are gonna be provided, and just bring a dish on the side. It's gonna be potluck style, but invite your friends. Obviously we have a big auditorium here, so we would love to fill it with you guys and your friends and family and whoever you'd like to invite. So all of those details are gonna be on our app or our website, so you could sign up for the Belong class or for the Super Bowl. But before we go into our last worship song, we have a special guest here. And last weekend was Sanctity of Life, and our partner Pathway Health Clinic is here, as you might have seen the baby bottles on the way in. And so I want to invite Leslie up. She has been working at Pathway Health Clinic for 12 years, and she has been the CEO for 6. And she is super passionate about the life-saving ministry of Pathway Health Clinic. So please welcome her. Welcome. You came on this. We love Leslie and Pathway Health Clinic. We've been partnering them for many years. But can you share with the congregation what Pathway Health Clinic does and what's your mission and goal?
Sure. Thank you so much for having me. It's always such an honor to come to this church. I feel like I'm home every time I come here. So Pathway, again, my name is Leslie Salazar-Carrillo. I'm the CEO of Pathway Health Clinic. For 25 years, we have been serving North County. We have been meeting women, men, and families in their greatest hour of need, when they're facing a crisis. And the heart of what we do is to come alongside her, come alongside them, and give them care that they can't receive anyplace else. We treat them with love, dignity, and respect. When she comes in, her heart is in a crisis because she thinks that she may be pregnant. So we're going to give her a no-cost pregnancy test. We're going to give her a no-cost ultrasound. We're going to give her opportunity to participate in our parenting program. But more than that, we give her hope. We step into her crisis. We sit with her in her situation, and we hear her. And sometimes we're the very first people in her life that have ever valued her.
Thank you so much. Yeah, I love that you guys just meet people in their crisis, and they come with no options, no other options. They feel like they have to make a decision, and you guys give them the option of a different choice. So I love that. Can you share a story of how your services have impacted the lives of many?
Oh my gosh, so we have 25 years of stories, but we would be here all afternoon. A couple weeks ago, a young woman walked in, and she said, I've been driving by here, and I keep wanting to stop. A year prior, we had seen her, and the phone call sounded like this. I'm calling you because my mom is making me. And I don't want to come, but I guess I'll come. And she was very abortion-minded. That was going to be her decision. And we did what we do. We loved her. We gave her the information that she needed. And she walked out the door, and we didn't know what decision she had made. But when she walked in, she had an 8-month-old baby in her arms. Yeah. And she said, I want to show you what you saved. I wish we had more stories like that, but we have tons and tons of stories like that, of lives changed, of hearts softened and healed.
And this is a sensitive subject in politics right now, but also people's lives. Not everyone has been a Christian their whole lives, or some people have made decisions that maybe they regret. What would you say to those people?
Oh, that's such a great question. That decision, like any other decision that maybe we are regretting, is leveled at the foot of the cross. And his blood covered that. And his desire is for each one of the people made in his image, called by him, to walk in that victory of that empty tomb. Because there is a very high price that was paid for that victory. And that is what we tell people. There is hope. There is forgiveness. And we are going to walk through you, with you through that. And so God can help you rebuild this new life that you have. And there is no condemnation, because there is no condemnation in Christ, and there is no condemnation from us. But we love you because he loved you first.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. So we would love to pray for Pathway Health Clinic right now. What are two things that we can be praying for?
Wisdom in decisions, the decisions that we are making, that we're having to make because of some external forces, and just that we would love well, that we would love her, that more people would find us so that we can love them well through whatever that they're going through.
Awesome. Well, church, will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that you are a God of life, that you are a God of hope, that you are a God of redemption and forgiveness, Lord. We pray that you would bless Pathway Health Clinic, that you would bless the work that they are doing, that you would bless the hands that are moving that ultrasound, that they would bring, you would bring more people to that clinic that need your help, that need hope, that need an option that is not one way, that there is multiple choices that they have with the support of Pathway Health Clinic and the church, Lord. We pray that you would give Leslie, the team, and Pathway Health Clinic wisdom and discernment on what they do and how they operate and who they hire and who's volunteers, Lord, that you would just put your hand upon them, that you would give them the Holy Spirit to fill that space, that people would meet you as they enter into that clinic. Lord, we pray for protection. We pray for just your love to penetrate these women's hearts, the family's hearts, that they would know that they are loved by you. That is our goal. And so we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And if you want to contribute, there are the baby bottles outside, so you guys can fill these up. Okay. Yep. Great. Love it.
Is that kind of like the hook?
Yeah.
Get off the stage
that
right now,
that was our
girls.
Cue. Okay. Okay. That is our cue. But you guys can be a part of Pathway Health Clinic through this, and they also need volunteers. So if you're an MFT or a medical professional, they would love to have you there. So definitely go check out them at the table.
Absolutely. One of these bottles filled with cash, check, or change is how we have kept our doors open for 25 years. Through this, you can change the world one heartbeat at a time. God bless you all. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you.
Y'all, we are going to continue in our time of worship, and we're about to pray for our offering. Let's stand together. But as we jump into this, I got a quick announcement. So this Thursday night, it's the first Thursday of the month, and we have our night of worship and prayer in the chapel. And I want to encourage all of you to come. I want to encourage you to be a part of that time. It is such an amazing, amazing time of worship and prayer where we together, as one body and one voice, get to lift up Jesus. And we get to dive deep into the heart of God. And so if you have ever thought, oh, I don't know if I'm going to come on Thursday night, this Thursday, crack open the door of your house, put the keys in the ignition, drive over here. And let's worship God together. We are going to, it's going to be an amazing night. We have an amazing crew helping us lead worship that are just going to melt your faces and melt your hearts. So it's going to be great. Well, we're going to pray for our offering. And so let's join me as we pray. Jesus, we thank you so much for the fact that you have blessed us with resources, God, that when we place them in your hands, God, you do much with what feels like little. And so this morning, God, as we give back to you out of the abundance that you've given to us, God, I pray that we would give from a place of trust, that we would give from a place, God, of freedom, God, that we would give from a place of joy. And would you use, God, the resources that we give back to you to further your kingdom work in organizations like Pathways, God, and here in our community and beyond the borders of this country, God. God, would you use the little that we have and make it much? We love you. We bless you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free.
My Father's house, there's a place.
chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am.
I am chosen. I'm a child. I'm a child of God. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Lord, we are so thankful that you have brought us in and you're never letting us go. So we lift all of this up to you, our thankfulness, your worthiness. We rest in that, that by your blood you have made us a part of your family. We love you, Lord. And everybody said amen. You guys can have a seat.
Well, thank you, worship team. Really blessed. Friends, my name's Nick. If we haven't met, in a second here, we're going to be continuing our sermon series in the book of Mark, the second half of the book of Mark. And we're actually going to be talking about sonship and daughtership today. I've entitled the sermon, A Tale of Four Sons. We're going to see the sons of ambition, James and John. We're going to see the son of obedience, Jesus Christ. We're going to see a guy called Bartimaeus, a son of desperation and hope. Before we get to that, though, I just wanted to say it's been a really heavy week, a heavy couple of weeks with all that's going on, you know. And today, as we celebrate life and as we celebrate the help that's been brought locally by a wonderful partner, I know you want to see Leslie as we go out. It's also a tough week. And with Tyre Nichols, the young man down in Memphis, killed this last week, and the shootings and all going on, I just wanted to take this pastoral moment for us as a church. What do we do? Of course, our prayers and thoughts. Of course, our prayers and thoughts. Absolutely. And more than that, that these hands that we have, friends, we're called to be peacemakers. We're called to move in with our words and our actions to be those who bring healing. So I just wanted to take this moment to say that, to remind us of that which we already know. Truth, I think, can be like that. That we needn't run from it. We actually ought to, if we are truly God's people, run to the places of pain. So I know there's myriad conversations you guys are having and multiple things going on, but I just want to pray a blessing over that before we move forth, all right? Lord, thank you for this church. Thank you for the life that's in this church. Thank you, Lord, for Pathway Health Clinic. Thank you for Leslie and our partners there and all that's going on. And Lord, this is a tough time in our nation, this nation that I've adopted, Lord. Our hearts break for it, so much pain, so much division. Lord, we ask that this would be a moment that your people would step up, that they would rise up, that they would step in, Lord, that we would come in serving, healing, being peacemakers. Father, we ask that with our words, they would not be ones that cause division, but that bring healing. With our actions that bring healing, not division. Father, lead us. Gosh, lead me, Lord. Lead us in this. Wonderful Lord, we pray. In your precious name, amen. Friends, when it comes to who we are in the Lord, I think we can have all kinds of wrong and one kind of right. I think that when it comes to our core identity, and of course, core identity and core purpose are inextricably linked, aren't they? I don't think we can know. In fact, could I have the slide up on screen, friends? As that old saying goes, we need to know whose we are to know who we are. And once we know who we are, then we can know what our quintessential, fundamental purpose is. The details, God will provide those, but we know what our core purpose is. But we need to begin by reminding ourselves, and today there's going to be a moment at the end where each of us, should we so choose, can have a moment to be reminded in our hearts. Not our minds, it's not a cerebral thing, but it's a heart matter to remind ourselves whose we are. We are His. He made us. We're made in His image. And sometimes that image can be so marred and broken and dusty and wrecked that we think, oh, He could never love me. God could never love me. I'm just too broken. And that's a lie. Friend, if you're harboring that lie deep down in the cockle of your heart, I need you to know that's not true. And at the other end of the spectrum, we can think, well, if I just performed a little better, just did a little more, God would somehow love me. And I want you to already know that also is a lie, that you're His beloved daughter, that you're His beloved son. He's well pleased with you. We're going to remind each other of that at the end of today. So just letting you know a little bit where we're going. If you want to grab open your Bibles or your book, or it'll be on screen, there's lots of things. We're going to be in Mark chapter 10, picking it up at verse 32. Apologies for the Australian accent. I think something's happening with the amplification. Don't worry about it. The more you talk with God, the more you sound Australian, because He's Aussie, by the way. Actually, I'm in the process of naturalization, so I'll be American. But anyway, that's another whole story. Okay, they were on their way up to Jerusalem. So Jesus and His disciples, on the way up to Jerusalem, with Jesus leading the way, and the disciples were astonished, while those who followed were afraid. Again, He took the 12 aside and told them what was going to happen to Him. This is now the third time within three chapters. We're going up to Jerusalem, He said, and the Son of Man, remember that Son of Man phrase, we're going to come back to that. In fact, as we read this, see how many references you see to sonship. And the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the teachers of the law. They will condemn Him to death and will hand Him over to the Gentiles, who will mock Him and spit on Him, flog Him and kill Him. 3 days later He will rise. Then James and John, and in Matthew's account it also says their mum came up. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to Him. Teacher, they said, we want you to do for us whatever we ask. What do you want me to do for you? He asked. And that's going to come up. That same question is going to come up again. What do you want me to do for you? He asked. They replied, Let one of us sit at your right and the other at your left in your glory. You don't know what you're asking, Jesus said. Can you drink the cup I drink or be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with? We can, they answered. Jesus said to them, you will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with. But to sit at my right or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared by my Father in heaven, one of the other accounts says. When the 10 heard about this, they became indignant with James and John. Jesus called them together and said, you know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Then they came to Jericho. As Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city, a blind man, Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus stopped and said, call him. So they called to the blind man, cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you. Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and he came to Jesus. What do you want me to do for you? Jesus asked him. The blind man said, Rabbi, I want to see. Go, said Jesus. Your faith has healed you. Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. God, I ask that you be with us today, speaking through your words of Scripture. Lord, I ask that you would diminish my voice, amplify your voice. Father, when it comes to these issues of core identity and who we truly are, Lord, I know it stirs things up, and I just ask that enemy Satan would be allowed no room to move. The old lies that have been spoken and whispered and even believed at points. Father, we ask that you would break that bondage, break those chains. Father, let us from this place today walk away from here knowing more fully, more truly, more wonderfully that we are yours, made in your image, and we are beloved of you. In Jesus' name, amen. So, like I said, some of us can fall to thinking that how could we be God's? How could we be made in his image? Others of us fall to thinking, if I could just do more, somehow God's going to be more impressed with me, love me somehow, just a little bit more. A number of years ago, I was in Swaziland. Actually, the name's changed. It's now called Eswatini. The king changed the name of the country. Just imagine that. Imagine Joe Biden saying, and by the way, we're going to be called Americanus or something, you know. But anyway, so I was there. And I was with Morgan Funke and the cause and this ministry, and it was out in the middle of nowhere. Now, if you know Eswatini or Swaziland, it's a very beautiful place, and the people are big-hearted and generous and wonderful people. And it's also a place of great hardship. Upwards of 40% of the women when I was there who were pregnant were HIV positive. Many of the kids grow up without any parenting. They often live with their grandmas. They're called go-gos. And we're out in the middle of nowhere, and we drove out a couple of hours from where we're staying to this little hut, and there was it was kind of looking around. I thought, what's going to happen here? And there were these go-gos, these grandmothers in there that were cooking these ginormous things of rice and all. And then these kids started rocking up from out of, I don't know where. I'm like, where did these guys come from? And there was like 36 kids. And they would eat a meal, and then they would have some tuition, and then they would go home to their different places, wherever they could find to sleep. And you know, I was there sitting and chatting with the kids. I love doing that sort of thing. Of course, you need to be careful in those circumstances that you don't unduly kind of cause attachment and such, because we're going to bail, but the kids are there, you know. And I was just there sitting and talking with the kids, but this one little guy came up, and he made his way up, and he came up, and he actually sat on my knee as I'm sitting there talking. And after he left, I noticed that he had sort of lost his bowels, you know, and his pants and my pants, where he'd been sitting, was a little funky. And anyway, and I went back. We drove back a couple of hours back to where we're staying, where there was at least intermittent power and also some water. And I was having a shower that night, and I was just thinking about the day, and it was kind of like, I want to say, like delayed heartache. And there was a moment I was scrubbing my leg, and then I remembered that the kid and all that, and I was scrubbing, and it's like my brain glitched, and I just couldn't stop, and I just kept on scrubbing, not out of like worry about hygiene, but just like, it was like I couldn't stop thinking about it. And I actually collapsed there in the shower. I was just weeping, and oh gosh, these kids, and it was sort of emblematic, this kid of the heartache. But I'm there, I'm the guy there from abroad, and I'm there to bring change and to do things, and I'm that guy. I suffer from that end of the spectrum, thinking that I can do things through hard work and performance and ambition and all of this, I can get stuff done. And that's wrong. And also these kids, I hope, and the ministry is there, letting them know that they are beloved of God, even though they're in extraordinarily bad circumstances. It was both of them at once. As we come to this passage, we remember, and Mark Freestead's sermon last week, oh my gosh, that was mind-boggling. Do you guys dig that? Wow, talking about the inverted kingdom, those who are last will be first, the first will be last, and the amazing teaching of that. And it said here that the disciples were astonished, and I wonder if it was at the teaching of Jesus, the authoritative nature of how he walked about. His ministry came from his core being, not doing. As my mum says, you're a human being, not a human doing, but it came from his core purpose, you know. And they were astonished, and I think they were also astonished about something else. You see, it says that they're on their way up to Jerusalem. Could I have up on the slide, guys? It's like it's a picture of a dusty road. Here we go. This is actually the road with Jericho's down the bottom, and Jerusalem is up the top. So this is kind of the bleakness of what they were walking to. And though it is north, Jericho is about 20 miles north of Jerusalem, they said up, because the elevation was maybe 3,500 feet. So going up to Jerusalem. Some theologians think that the language is also symbolic, because in Jerusalem, Jesus was going to be put up. But either way, do you notice what Jesus is doing? Jesus is leading the way. It's very purposeful. Even though he's already told them once, twice, just about now three times, he's going up to suffer greatly. He's leading. He's purposeful. He's setting his face like a flint towards that which God has called him to do. His purpose is clear. Like nobody else before or since, he knew whose he was. Because he knew whose he was, he knew who he was. Because he knew who he was, he knew what his purpose was. Those who followed were afraid. There's a large crowd going up. The time of year, the time of the Passover, there would have been many pilgrims going up towards Jerusalem. And why were they afraid? I don't know. I mean, it was a time of insurrections. It was a couple of hundred years before with the Maccabean revolt. But then, you know, in BC 63, when the Romans took over, they were frequently crushing Jewish revolts. They were like, you know, what's that joke? The peasants are revolting. Yes, I know. You know, like they're constantly in this state of perpetual revolt. Okay, and so maybe they thought, oh, we're going to get stuck in some kind of insurrection. This guy Jesus, he's a very mercurial kind of, you know, figure that's dividing people. What are we going to get stuck in this? Maybe they were just afraid. Maybe, here's a thought, maybe when it comes to Jesus, I mean the real Jesus, not the pretend Jesus, not the Jesus in my pocket, not the Jesus who I put over there on the shelf, but the real Jesus, maybe that actually, either awe and fear and kind of astonishment, maybe these are in fact the right kind of reactions that we ought to have to him. But all this is going on, Jesus takes the 12 aside and he tells them again what's going to happen to him. Chapter 8, verse 31, chapter 9, verse 31, chapter 10, verse 32. It was almost like it was foreordained that this, it was in this order. He says, we're going up to Jerusalem, he said, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests. Now, this term, Son of Man, we've talked about this before. It's a very ambiguous term. It can mean Son of Man, like a human son. Yet it can also mean a whole lot more than that. And I think it's indicative of Jesus' love and respect for us that he says, you decide for you who you think I am. It's not going to change who he is, but it's going to change our understanding of him. It can be a Son of Man, it can be a human son, or it can be a lot more. Can I have up on screen, friends, the quotation from Daniel? So keep in mind, this is 550 years before Christ. That Daniel, his prophetic words spanned, 60 or 70 years. But here he's under the rule of Belshazzar in Babylon, hundreds and hundreds of miles away from where Jesus was. But he has a vision of what is coming. And here's what he says, in my vision at night, this is Daniel speaking, I looked and there before me was one like a son of man coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days, God the Father. This is the Yahweh. This is God the Father. And all nations and peoples of every language worshipped this Son of Man. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. Hang on a second. The Son of Man is worthy of worship? Only one person in the universe is worthy of worship. Only, in fact, one person in the universe can withstand worship. It's a curse for everybody else. Just look at all the dysfunctional famous people that you know of. There's only one person who is worthy of worship, who can withstand worship, and that is God himself. This is the Son of Man. And Jesus says, this Son of Man, speaking of himself, self-referencing, says, going to be delivered over. They're going to condemn him to death and hand him to the Gentiles who will mock on him, spit him. 3 days later, he will rise. This is a prediction. Now, let's look at this little section on what I'm going to call the sons of ambition. So, James and John, the sons of Zebedee, come to him. Can I have the next slide up? It's a picture of a... there we go. Perfect. Like I said, so Mark is one of the biographies in the Bible that we have about Jesus. If you're new to the whole churchianity sort of, biznit, right? So, and Mark is one of them. There's another one called Matthew. And they operate at giving different eyewitness accounts of the same circumstances often enough. So it's not that they're in conflict. It's like they flesh out and fully flesh out each other. In Matthew's account, it also says that their mum came up. Now, James and John, so it's thought, their mother was called Salome, and she's at the foot of the cross. She's an amazing disciple of Christ. And so it's thought that Salome is actually the sister of Mary, Jesus' mother. That is to say, James and John were cousins, so it's thought, of Jesus through Mary's side. But either way, they come up here and come to him. Jesus, they said... Or they said, teacher, this kind of honorific, a little bit suck-holy, excuse my French. But they came up and they say, we want you to do for us whatever we ask. Now, anyone out there, parents especially, you know, when that's said, that what's coming next is something that's a little bit iffy. Something you've got to have your radar up for that might not be exactly the thing which I think. And by the way, at that point, if you're a new parent, don't ever give a carte blanche kind of blank check. That's a bad moment to do that, right? What do you want? We want you to do for us whatever we ask. And he says, what do you want me to do for you? That comes up later on, those of you who noticed, doesn't it, with Bartimaeus. His motivation is different. Let's see what happens here. They said, we want to sit at your right and your left when you come in your kingdom. And the language here actually implies that they still don't understand that his kingdom is not an earthly kingdom. They think it's going to be that, you know, all that talk about going and dying and all that sort of stuff. And they, it's like the disciples have interpreted it. Maybe it's kind of like a Shakespearean monologue about, you know, blow wind, come rack, at least we'll die with harness on our back kind of stuff. Like, it's just this stoic kind of go into battle, whatever. They just don't get it. They think he's still going to be this fulfillment of this earthly expectation that they had. He'll throw off the Romans, he will set up a kingdom here on earth. And when it happens, could we sit at your right and your left? And by the way, you know, here's Mumsy, and you know we're your cousins. I mean, you know, it's just the way it should go. A little bit of nepotism here, a little bit of nepotism there. He says, you don't know what you're asking. On so many levels. And he says, can you drink the cup I drink or be baptized with my baptism? Can I have the slide up, friends? It's like a gigantic cup. Okay, now this is, there's a guy called Cole Thomas. He was an 18th century British guy. And this is called the Titan's Goblet, right? Like the goblet of the gods. I just thought it was great to give the vastness of the thought of a cup that is full. Because when Jesus says, can you drink the cup I'm drinking? What it is actually really is a reference to the Old Testament, the cup of God's wrath that is going to be poured out on injustice, on enmity. This wrath, this pure justice, we cannot stand before. Jesus is going to drink it down to his very dregs on the cross. But the vast, and that is not even, it would be much bigger than that, of course, in reality, if it was proportionate. Jesus says, can you really drink the cup? I'm going to drink. Can you be baptized with my baptism of fire? And them being idiots, not as much an idiot as me, but certainly idiots, they're like, yeah, of course we can. And you know, it's funny because Jesus doesn't give them like the karate stop. He actually says, well, you know, you're actually going to suffer. And that's true. Looking back upon this years later, James was the first of the disciples who was martyred. He had his head chopped off under King Herod Agrippa I. The first. John outlived all the other apostles, all the other disciples. He was probably the youngest of the disciples, but he outlived them all. But he saw heinous suffering through his life. Dozens and dozens, if not hundreds of Christians martyred for their faith, thrown to wild animals, burnt at the stake. There was a time Tertullian talked about it when John was actually cast into a cauldron of boiling oil because they wanted to kill him in front of the Colosseum. And it didn't work. It was like a botched execution. And he came out of it and he was alive. And everyone was like, what? You know, in fact, it was apparently the entire Colosseum was converted. And the officials, so annoyed, they sent him off to this island of Patmos, where, of course, he wrote the book, what we have in our Bibles, of Revelation. But what I'm saying is, like, he too knew suffering. Jesus says, actually, you will suffer. He said, but what you're asking, it's not for me to grant. He said, what you're asking is set aside for those whom has been prepared, and prepared by my Father in heaven. Can I have up the slide of the Trinity, friends? Okay, so I apologize for distilling really a billion pages of thinking and writing into one short infographic. Lord, forgive me. But here's the thing. I'm not going to explain the Trinity because I actually don't think an eternity of eternities is going to be enough for us to get our heads around this crazy mystery. That God exists in three persons, eternally, all equal, all God. And you know, there's the Father who is God, but he's not the Son, and the Son is not the Spirit, but the Son is God, and the Spirit is God. You kind of get it's a pretty simple thing. I don't want to talk about that. In fact, it'll probably cook our noodles. So I don't want to do that. What I do want to talk about is the role of submission within the Trinity. They are co-equal, and yet the Son submits himself to the will of the Father. He became obedient to death, even death on a cross, it says in Philippians 2, a marvelous passage about Jesus being God and also submitting himself to the will of the Father. Here it's a reminder of that. God the Father is going to be the one who's going to give these places to those that he's prepared it for. In verse 41, the 10 heard about this, and they became indignant with James and John because, you know, they had got in first. Or maybe they're indignant because, you know, what presumption? How could they think to do that? Oh, I just think it's because, wow, that was a really good idea. I should have asked that first. Wonder what angle I could. Well, I'm not related to him, but, you know, we both grew up in that place, and I know a little bit about carpentry. I don't know. But here's the point where we're transitioning now into talking about the son of obedience. And you know, it's really fascinating. In each of the three times that Jesus predicts his suffering and his death, two things happen immediately afterwards. First thing, there's a vying for position amongst the disciples, like they just didn't hear it. Then immediately next, Jesus teaches on discipleship. That's exactly what happens here. He says, look, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles, they lord it over them. We have this hierarchy and the way we work and all that. He said, not so with you. Those who are my disciples, those who truly follow me, that's not the way of it. If you want to be great, you must be the servant. And if you want to be first, to be the slave of all, to care for everyone. And friends, we are so blessed. I am so blessed to be here at our church where we have Ryan and Stacey, where we have our board who serve all of us. This is really a service-orientated church, servant-hearted leadership. So blessed. And then there's this one here, and this is like a hinge verse for the entire Gospel of Mark. This is the closest that it comes to an explanation of Jesus' work on the cross. For even the Son of Man, the Daniel 7 Son of Man, did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. And ransom is not like we think of when someone's hijacked and you pay them 50 grand to get your kid back or whatnot. That's not what he's talking about. The emphasis here is on those who are slaves because of their parents' bad planning and stupidity, and their own stupidity, they're in slavery. About a third of the Roman Empire were slaves. So this is a very common sort of image, and it was very, very rare, almost impossible for slaves to earn enough money to get their own freedom. But here, it's those who are bought out of slavery, who are bought and brought out of slavery by the work of Christ on the cross. And if you've been bought here today by a buddy, a friend, and you don't know Jesus, you don't follow Jesus, 10 seconds for you, my friend. How can Jesus pay the ransom for you and your freedom? Maybe you don't even think you need it. But then deep down, when you think about it, you know that you're constrained by sin, by brokenness. He is God. And yet he forsook his glory and he came to earth and became a baby. Then he lived as a man and he never sinned. And because he never sinned, it means that when he went to the cross, he was the only one ever who was worthy of drinking that cup, taking our sin, taking our iniquity, the awful things that we've done, the awful things that have been done to us, and he finished with them once and for all on the cross. Then he rose again from the dead, proving that he's victorious over sin and death. And he offers us the gift of eternal life. When it says ransom, that's what it's talking about. He has won your freedom. Do you choose to be constrained? Like our dog who last week went down to Mexico for the snip trip. We found a vet down there. The snip, I'm not going to explain on that. Go and talk to someone out in the courtyard. And he's this massive dog. He's like that red dog that just keeps on growing. You know, what's that kid's story? That one? That's our dog. He's just, every time I look at him, he's bigger. And it was going to cost, you know, too much money to get him done up here. And anyway, so he came back, and he needs to be constrained in this little cage. But you could not make a cage big enough for our dog. He's called Huzzy. And Huzzy, but we've got this thing, and even though he's gigantic now, he remembers it from when he was a puppy. I can't get out of that. It's too big for me to get out of. But actually, it's not. But he thinks it is. And sometimes we can be like that with our sin. But just so you know, you can be freed. So we've talked about the sons of ambition. We've talked about the son of obedience. And you know, there's this beautiful time when Jesus is being baptized. It's in Mark chapter 1. Ryan talked about it. Where Jesus comes down to be baptized at the River Jordan. And he comes down, and his crazy cousin is there. We've all got a crazy cousin. John the Baptist is there, and he's dipping locusts in honey and biting off their heads and saying crazy stuff, whatever. And Jesus comes up, and as he comes up, John says, "Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world." And Jesus is there like, "Dude, I'm trying to keep it on the DL, just, you know, whatever. And I'm here to actually for you to baptize me." And he goes, "Oh, I'm not even worthy to untie your sandals. How can I baptize you?" And he goes, "No, just stick with it." And they're right. And he goes under, he comes out. Here's my point. As he comes out, it says, the Spirit descended on him like a dove. Gosh, I'd love to see that. God the Spirit is there. It's a real powerful Trinitarian moment, actually. But then these words come from heaven, from Father God. I want to speak this over you, and at the end of today, this is going to be spoken over you. God says to him, "This is my son, who I love, in whom I'm well pleased. This is my son, whom I love, in whom I'm well pleased." And at this point, I just want to point out that at least according to the biblical record, Jesus had done precisely no miracles. At this point, unless there's something that we don't know about, Jesus had amazed them with astonishing teaching in precisely zero synagogues. At this point in his life and ministry, Jesus had died for the world and been resurrected from the dead precisely zero times. My point being, his sonship was assured because of the Father's love. And if you're a performance person, you think, "I just do this and make him love me," I just need you to know that it's a form of pride and it's a form of sin, and you need to forsake it. You need to stand and receive his love, that you are his beloved daughter. He's well pleased with you. You're his son, and he loves you, and he's very pleased with you. We're going to come to that in a bit. We've talked about the sons of ambition. We've talked about the son of obedience, this wonderful son, Jesus of obedience. And now, here we are. We're going to come into land. We're looking at the son of desperation and hope, Bartimaeus. Son of Timaeus. Bar means son of. And you know, funnily enough, in the Synoptic Gospels, he's the only healed person, the person who's healed, who is given a name. But this name is kind of an indirect name. He's defined by otherness. He's defined by his father. That's the blind guy. That's the son of Timaeus, the blind guy. They come to Jericho, and as Jesus and his disciples were there, and they're leaving the city. In fact, with Jericho, there was old Jericho and new Jericho, so archaeologists say. And the one place by then was sort of destitute. A lot of beggars would hang out there, people who didn't have a home. And then right next to it, juxtaposed right next to it, there was a kind of a flasher part, and like a resort part even. And often, like when you get those two things together, there's a lot of begging going that goes on. Bartimaeus was not alone. The other accounts talk about there being more than one. There was lots of people here likely begging. And he's there, Bartimaeus, this blind guy in Jericho, middle of nowhere. But he can see better than any of the scribes, any of the Pharisees, any of the authorities. He can see better than any of the disciples. He says, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Oh, there's another reference to a son. And by the way, it's not, you know, just sons today, and because of the exclusion of daughters, it just happens to be this is what the scripture's on. But can I have up on screen the it's Jeremiah 23, I think it's 23. Oh, perfect. So, apart from Daniel, about, you know, the Son of Man, thousands of miles away in Judah, around about the same time, in fact, 50 years earlier, about 600 BC, Jeremiah, the prophet to Judah, is also in the business of talking about this coming Messiah. And this is what he says, and this is like son of David, which means not literally the David's son, but someone in the lineage of King David, the Davidic king. The days are coming, declares the Lord through Jeremiah, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch. And by the way, these caps are in the NIV. A righteous branch, a king who will reign wisely and do what is just and right in the land. And this is the name by which he will be called. You ready? The Lord, our righteous Savior. All these caps are in the Bible, and the Lord is in all caps, which means Yahweh. It's in the Hebrew, which the Old Testament mainly was written in, Yahweh. He will be called Yahweh, our righteous Savior. This is the Son of David. You understand here, this is a very, very strong image of saying that he is God. Jesus is God. Bartimaeus sees it. He's less blind than all the people who can see. And everyone just told him to shut the heck up. Just give it a break, dude. This guy doesn't have time for you. He's a rock star. He's going up. He's talking all this crazy stuff about death, but we think he's actually going to go up. You've seen the miracles he's done. He's probably going to, you know, kill the Romans, set up the kingdom, blah, blah, blah. They tell him to be quiet. He shouts out all the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. Desperation and hope commingled. Jesus stops. Jesus sees him that everyone else would pass on by. Can I have that slide up, guys? It's the last slide. And this, by the way, is from this great blog I read by Friar Derek Sarkowski. It's called The Cloak of Bartimaeus. I put it in the online notes that I'm pretty sure just me and one other person out there read. But anyway, that's where they are. And this picture is there as well. Verse 50, throwing his cloak aside. Probably, maybe a stick, but apart from that, probably the cloak was this guy's only possession. I mean, gosh, the Old Testament, the laws are just full of these exhortations to care for those who can't care for themselves. Leviticus 25, I mean, it's all through the Old Testament. But by Jesus' time, especially blindness was considered a curse. In fact, James and John, when another point in Jesus' ministry, they came across a blind guy, they're like, well, who sinned? Was it him or was it his parents? But the assumption is that someone must have sinned. And Jesus is like, no. But this guy, this human, every human made in the image of God, but this guy, broken, likely beaten up many times, people stealing from him, walking past him, not even human. You know, the worst thing you can do for a human is to not even see them. Believe it or not, psychologically, it's even worse than abuse, is total just, you don't exist. Denying their humanity. This cloak, and so this guy, Derek Sarkowski, talks about, probably became a place of refuge, a place of solace, place of safety for him, thin as it was. And I'm going to read here what he said. What does your cloak look like? What does your cloak feel like? Where in your life do you find yourself hiding or isolating, pulling away from relationship, or preferring the predictable comfort and safety of self-soothing or self-protection? How do you feel about casting aside your cloak and running vulnerably to Jesus to be healed? How do you? Or do you go back to the old things? But here, Bartimaeus throws his cloak aside. And I don't know how he jumped to his feet and he came to Jesus. I imagine him running to Jesus. He's blind. Did he trip over and skin his knees? He doesn't care. He doesn't go back for his cloak. Do you notice that? He comes and Jesus asks him, and I ask you today, What do you want Jesus to do for you? And the blind man said, Rabbi, I want to see. Rabboni is actually the term. It's like a real loving, intimate term, like beloved teacher, dear Lord, master, dear master. I want to see. I want to see. He could already see better than anyone else. But he wants to see physically as well. And Jesus heals him. And then he follows him down the road. Can I invite our worship friends to come back out here? Let's all jump to our feet just now. Because we're going to do something. And when I say we, you know that I mean you. And it's going to be a little bit cheesy. It's going to be a little bit hokey, but don't worry, you can get over it. And at this point, I'd like to please ask all of our guys who are our pastors and directors, if you guys could go to the exits, and also any of our home group leaders, any of our small group leaders, if you could also go out there. And they're going to, a little bit kerfuffle, they're going to go in and out, so don't worry about it. But they're going to be going out there and getting ready for something that we're about to do. And here's what it is. As we sing this song, I want us to get our hearts ready, because maybe at some point along the line, we've listened to the whispers of enemy Satan, that God couldn't love me. I know I'm made in his image, but I'm so dinged up, I'm so beat up, I'm so bedraggled and marred that he couldn't love me. It's a lie. I need you to know it's a dreadful, awful lie. And others of us think, if I could just do a little bit more, if I could just do that extra thing and karate chop that throat of that problem a little harder, that God's going to somehow love me. And that's a lie as well. At the other end of it, that's not true. He loves you. And today, as you go, and the guys outside, and just so you're not weirded out by it, they've got these little vials of oil. And this is going to be a moment for the church to be the church, where you go out and they're going to get the oil. They're just going to doink your head, or, you know, just smudge a little bit on your head. And it's olive oil or something, so don't worry about your makeup. It's going to be good. And they're going to say, you're God's son, and he loves you, and he's very pleased with you. Or you're God's daughter, and he loves you, and he's very pleased with you. So ready your hearts for that, friends. Let's sing this song together. Let it be an anthem for our hearts. Let it be an anthem for our souls, so that we can prepare ourselves for that.
So what could I say? And what could I do? But offer this heart, oh God, completely to you. So what could I say? And what could I do? But offer this heart, oh God, completely to you. So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. Lord, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am is yours. Oh, I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. Lord, I'll stand my soul. Surrender all.
so, friends, as we pass from this place today, may you more deeply know than you ever have before. Even if it's just the beginning of an inkling of a thought, of a contemplation, or if it's in a very deep and profound way, whose you are, that you would know whose you are. And that you would know who you are on the basis of that. And you'd understand your core purpose, your fundamental purpose to follow Jesus down the road. And as you go out, and if it's too weird for you, don't worry, you just walk on by, the friends will high five and wave at you. But let's go out and let's let the church be the church. Let's anoint and love on each other. Lord, I thank you for this church, for the life in it, that we get to be part of it. What an honor, what a privilege, Lord. Father, I pray for my brothers and my sisters, especially those, Lord, today who are just, they've believed dreadful lies. They've been constrained by something that needn't constrain them, Lord. Let them be free. We love you and we praise you and we thank you in your name. Amen. My whole heart.
Jesus, you saved us.